from Gothenburg, I went back to Aarhus in the beginning of the 80s, I think. I think it was the end of the 70s. And we continued, even when I was in Aarhus, we continued the collaboration on the subject of regeneration. And in 83, I took over the chairmanship in paleontology after Wolf Edstrom. And in that context, I think I should maybe mention that we also, after some time, developed a postgraduate program. And also, I had several students on unofficial education as a, before the program was established, and also after. We had, after some years, we had to close the program because of bad economy. But in fact, today I have several students, three actually, who are chairmen in the, in Europe of a Pierron department. There is Anthony Scullion in Bern, and there is Stavropoulos in Malmö, and Donus in Eastman for the postgraduate, chief for the postgraduate program there. And but I have had several young people, also many of them had continued in their in research when they went home. I had many from Greece, and we had a very fantastic environment, in fact, at that time, where we were examining many different things. As a, even I had a medical person who was actually examining if membranes could use for the healing of long bones. And it was interesting results, because in the long bones it was not enough with a membrane, but if we put demineralized bone matrix in there, then the tube bone just heals like a tube, but just with a membrane they just round it off. But maybe the tissue, bone tissue, need a matrix to grow on. It cannot grow out in, I think, soft tissue or or blood clot. And I had a Russian also. She's now in Holland and in private practice. So there were many, many different people involved, and I can even not remember all what they were doing now as they started. Also saying that that's a problem when you get older. At the same time, I was also, I was actually the dean of the school for 10 years. I had the task to clear up all like economical problems. They had an idea that they would close down the school. They proposed to close the school first in 1984. Then they ended up that we had to save a lot of money. Then they started again in 1989. And that also ended up with the fact that we should save a lot of money. But at the same time, we were forced to go into the university. Before, we were a separate school. And I took over the deanship in 1991. So I got all the task to fire all the people. We're in a certain economical frame. And also to deliver the dental school into the university. And it's a hard task, I can tell you, when you have to get rid of so many people. you don't get so popular. But I kept the position in 10 years. And they didn't throw me out, but I went out by myself, so I didn't lose, because it was something to be a dean. It was not something you just got, you see. To become the dean, that was like being elected as president of the United States. We had a voting campaign, you know, because everybody in the school in this time of democracy, they could vote for the dean, or who should be the dean. So that was the students even, that was all the technical personnel and the clinical assistants and nurses and all the academic personnel. So it was repeated every 4 years. And I can tell you, it was like an American campaign. So, but in some way, it was also fun. But it took some time, I must admit that it was difficult to just keep the research going and at the same time also deal with these administrative problems. And I was the chairman at the same time of the Peronal Department, because that was, because the deanship was, as I say, a 4 year position, then you had to be revoted and so on. So you couldn't give up the chairmanship because of the deanship. I retired in 2007, 70 years old. At that time, when I was introduced to doing research in animals, it was not so difficult. We got a license from the government, and then I could do whatever I wanted. Then by time it got more and more controlled in the way that we should have it renewed every 5th year, and then we should talk a little about what we were going to do. And but later again they almost tried, but that was before I stopped, they tried that we should send in for approval every experiment we were going to do. I mean, that's a fantastic bureaucracy. And particularly when we actually have to send our animal logbook in for control every year. But to make a long story short, it has become so difficult now because of animal rights groups to do research in animals. So I don't think it's possible actually, or it is at least very difficult to get allowed to do research now in dentistry, because it's not a life-threatening disease. So I think I've been privileged to live in a time when animal research were allowed to a great extent, because such studies or such knowledge as we have got was impossible to get from if we couldn't do animal studies. I mean, it's not possible to use rats or anything in dental treatment. So, I also think you would see in the journals that there's very, very little animal research in dentistry now. I think that implants is the greatest change. I mean, when I started, it was impossible to think about that you could make a third dentition, which is functioning such as the implants are doing today. I think that's a fantastic. It's a sort of a way to completely avoid edentulousness. So, but otherwise, I think that all hygiene development. And the result of all hygiene in the population is a fantastic thing also. Here in this country, for instance, we start already with the children, and they have a dentist in the school and are taught to brush their teeth and so on. So I think that the connection between periodontal disease and oral hygiene is a fantastic development which has happened in my time. I would say, if I say Harlø, he was a fantastic researcher with common sense. And then I will mention Jan Linde. He is also one I really admire for his logical way to present things. And he has done fantastic in distributing knowledge in periodontology. And then I think Sture Nyman, which I worked together with, he was also a very clever person with common sense in doing his research. That was probably the reason that we could work together. Yes, and I also admire Ramfjord a lot because he did some really fantastic studies in a completely another environment than we have it today. What avenue I would take if I should start dentistry to study dentistry today? To start in dentistry after I have graduated, you mean? Yeah, I think I still choose periodontology. And I'll probably continue to work with regeneration combined with implants, I think. The textbook of clinical periodontology and implant dentistry, my role as a co-author there. Yeah, first of all, we started with a Scandinavian edition, Jan Linde, Sture Nyman and myself, where we not wrote everything ourselves, but also invited some authors. Later we developed it in the way that we discussed who to invite to that. Jan Linde, he has taken more and more over the edition of it, but we still have the our article or the chapters in where we have to renew them when there is a new edition. No, there has come a new edition now. We haven't changed the anatomy chapter, but I'm also withdrawing more and more from this book. So I think that's will the last time. But on the other hand, I wonder who can make one chapter in anatomy now when we talked about the animal studies one. Because if you look upon that, all the histology there in the anatomy chapter, that's impossible to do without animals. So maybe it will just stay there forever. Without my name, which maybe next one can get it. Yeah, that's Louis Armstrong. If I required an answer, I think it's Louis Armstrong. And you know, I'm also brought up in my young ages by jazz, so I think Armstrong is pleasant for me to listen to.